above all things. His love endures forever. Sing praise.
Hello everyone, I'm so glad you're here with me today. We're going to get into the Word of God in just a minute, and if you are ready to receive from what the Holy Spirit wants to show to you today, I'm going to tell you, be prepared to be blessed, because when the Word of God comes upon you, you're going to receive such wisdom, you're going to receive such peace, such joy from the Lord. So why don't we go ahead, let's start off with the word of prayer. Let's pray. Father God, we just want to thank you, Lord, for this day, knowing that our hearts belong to you. Father, We are full of rejoice. And we thank you, Lord, knowing that you love us so much. We want to honor you in this time as we allow your words to sink so deep within our hearts. We want to give this time fully unto you. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray all these things. And we say, amen. Praise God. Praise God. Well, you know, last week we started a new sermon series called Church in Desperate Need of CPR. And CPR, in this case, doesn't mean cardiopulmonary resuscitation, as it is commonly known. Well, if you remembered, I indicated that CPR, actually, in this sermon, is going to refer to Christians pumped for revival. And, you know, I mentioned that in the book of Revelation, you know, Jesus referred to the church of Sardis as being dead and needed to be spiritually revived. Now, with all the problems and troubles that we are now facing, you know, many of our churches here in America also need to be spiritually revived. And it seems that we got to dig deep within our souls and spirits and cry out to God in total desperation to show him that we truly believe that he is the only one that can save us from all this turmoil and destruction. And you know, I pointed out that God has given us the answer to what we need to do in order to truly experience a complete, I'm talking a complete turnaround from our present situations. And this is found in 2 Chronicles chapter 7, verse 14. Starting with verse 14, let me go ahead and read it to you. It says, "Then if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, I will hear from heaven and I will forgive their sins and I will restore their land. My eyes will be open and my ears attentive to every prayer made in this place, for I have chosen this temple and set it apart to be holy, a place where my name will be honored forever. I will always watch over it, for it is dear to my heart." You know, last week in part one, we talked about a sackcloth and ashes kind of humility that we must have in order to have a revival. Well, this week in part two, we're talking about the way we should pray in order to see the hand of God move powerfully in our lives. You know, as I sought the Holy Spirit about it, I believe he revealed the answer to me in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verses 16 to 19. And this is what it says here. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, starting with verse 16. It says here, "Rejoice always, pray without ceasing, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. Do not quench the Spirit." And you know, through this verse, I believe the Apostle Paul reveals to us three things that we must do in our lives in order to experience great revival through our prayers. So here's the question. What must we do in our lives in order to pray powerfully and experience great revival? Well, number one, it says here, we must rejoice always. And I believe that having a life filled with the joy of the Lord is key to having a powerful, powerful prayer life. But you know, as Solomon points out in Ecclesiastes chapter 7, verse 14, it is not only in the good times in our lives that we are to have this kind of joy. Let me go there right now. Let me read it to you, what it says here. Ecclesiastes 7, 14. It says here, "When the times are good, be happy. But when times are bad, consider this: God has made the one as well as the other. Therefore, no one can discover anything about their future." You know, I gotta say, it's really a sign of spiritual maturity when we can have the joy of the Lord in the good times and the bad. Because a lot of times we think, no, we're only happy when times are good. Well, if you truly know Jesus, if you have Jesus deep in your heart, you know what? Even in the bad times, you know the joy of the Lord is with you. And you know, even James, he reiterates this in James chapter 1, verse 2. Look what it says there. It says, "Count it all joy, my brothers, when you meet trials of various kinds. And, you know, we got to remember also what Job, you remember Job? What he went through after he lost all his wealth, all his possessions, and most of his family members. You know, if that wasn't enough, Satan also had another test in mind. I want to read to you what it says here in Job chapter 2, starting with verse 3. It says here, "Then the Lord asked Satan, 'Have you noticed my servant Job? He's the finest man in all the earth. He is blameless, a man of complete integrity. He fears God and stays away from evil. And he has maintained his integrity even though you urge me to harm him without cause.' And Satan replied to the Lord, 'Skin for skin. A man will give up everything he has to save his life, but reach out and take away his health, and he will surely curse you to your face.'" Verse 6 says, "All right, do with him as you please," the Lord said to Satan, "but spare his life." So verse 7, it says here, "So Satan left the Lord's presence, and he struck Job with terrible boils from head to foot. And Job scraped his skin with a piece of broken pottery as he sat among the ashes. His wife said to him, 'Are you still trying to maintain your integrity? Curse God and die.'" Wow, can you imagine his wife saying that to him? And verse 10, it says, "But Job replied, 'You talk like a foolish woman. Should we only accept good things from the hand of God and never anything bad?' So in all this, Job said nothing wrong." You know, I have to say, it takes great spiritual maturity to accept the bad things that may have happened to you in your life and not say anything wrong or bad against God. But you know, it takes an exceptional spirituality to rejoice and praise God when everything really is falling apart around you. I want you to look what it says here in 1 Peter chapter 4, verses 12 to 14. It says here, "Dear friends, do not be surprised at the fiery ordeal that has come on you to test you as though something strange were happening to you. But rejoice inasmuch as you participate in the sufferings of Christ, so that you may be overjoyed when his glory is revealed. If you are insulted because of the name of Christ, you are blessed, for the Spirit of glory and of God rests on you." I want you to think about this for a second. You know, if we can make the choice not to panic and lose our heads when the difficult times come, because guess what? They will come for everybody, right? You may not be experiencing right now, but guess what? It just may come at any time. You know, but if we can allow ourselves to remain calm, not push the panic button, you know what? We can learn to rise above the pain and suffering, just like how Jesus did, because he went through a lot of suffering, a lot of shame, a lot of pain, you know, for sure, as he hung on the cross. But it's a choice we make. Are we going to allow ourselves to freak out and panic, or are we going to just remain calm? And just remember, you know, what Jesus did for us. And remember, God gives us the strength to rise above the worst of things that can happen in our life if we truly trust in him. You know, there's this American author. His name is Leo Buscaglia. And he tells a story about his mother and their misery dinner. You know, it was the night after his father came home and said it looked as if he would have to go into bankruptcy because his partner had somehow embezzled money from their firm's funds, and he just kind of took off and was never to be seen again. And his mother went out, and you know what she did? She sold some jewelry, her own jewelry, to buy food for a sumptuous feast. And you know, some of the members of her family scolded her for it. But you know what she said? She told them that the time for joy is now, when we need it the most, not for next week. And you know, her courageous act rallied the family together. And you know, it really shows that she is a woman who will not allow bad situations to affect the joy that she wants for her and her family at all times. You know, it's how we respond at that moment will determine how things will be for our life from that moment on. You know, in times of great pain and suffering, our minds and hearts must fully connect to God. It must connect to Jesus. And we got to remember, you know, yeah, it seems like what we're going through is pretty bad. But what did Jesus go through? You know, he was totally innocent, yet he was willing to suffer and die for us on the cross. Look what it says here in Psalm 94, verses 18 to 19. Look what David says here. He says, "When I said, my foot is slipping, your unfailing love, O Lord, supported me. When anxiety was great within me, your consolation brought me joy." Wow. And that's one thing we can really learn to focus on. You know, when times get really bad, times are really, really to the point where you're just screaming and you're tearing the hairs out of your head, you know, that's a time to remember how much God loves you, how much he wants you to come to him. And you gotta understand his love, as the scripture says, is unfailing. And when you can go to God and say, "Lord, I remember what you did for me, and I'm just crying out to you, and I remember it's your love, O Lord, that is here for me right now. And you're here to support me, and you're here to give me strength. Thank you, Lord." And you know, sometimes that's all we gotta do. Take a deep breath and say, "Lord, I know you're here. I trust you, and I know, Father, you're going to help me. You're going to see me through this, and I'm going to give you all the glory." Amen. Well, I want you to look at point number two now. It says here, the second thing we got to do is pray without ceasing, as the scripture tells us. And you know, to be honest, this command from Paul to pray without ceasing, it can be kind of confusing if you're not really familiar with the scriptures. And obviously, it cannot mean that we are to walk around at all times with our heads bowed, our hands clasped, and with our eyes closed, and talk nonstop with God. And well, if you do that, people may think there's something wrong with you. But we know, right? What Paul is actually referring to is more of an attitude of being conscious of God and surrendering to him at all times. You know, it's always being aware that God is always with us and he is always accessible to us whenever we need him. You know, like someone may tell you, "I'm just a phone call away." Well, you know what? God says, "I'm just a call away. You call on me, you call on my son, I'll be there for you, child." And you know, he's always actively involved in our lives, as any good parent is, right? He's always involved. He's always knowing what's going on in your life because he loves you. He loves me. And he's always there to counsel us at all times. And when you just call on him, you'd be amazed. He's going to speak wisdom into you. And you may think, "Wow, where did this thought come from?" Well, I want to tell you where. It's from him. It's from Father God. It's from the Holy Spirit, as you simply call on him. And you know, we can be having conversations with God throughout the day, and we got to realize that's prayer. Because some people say, "No, that's not real." No, that is prayer. You know, whether you're asking his opinion about something or just expressing how you feel about a certain situation you're facing right now, or about someone or something in particular. It should be that when we start to worry or have anxious thoughts or have fear or discouragement or anger, guess what? We can immediately switch these thoughts into prayer mode. Because you know what? When we didn't know God, yeah, we would just continue to worry and just become more anxious, and we get to the point where we're just not knowing what to do. We're in a panic state of mind. But as Christians, we gotta learn to switch it off, and we gotta go right to that point where we're saying, "Father God, I need you. Instead of thinking, okay, I'm going to lose my job. Oh no, what's going to happen? Oh, I guess I'm never going to become a successful person anymore. You just stop right there and you switch it to prayer mode. Father God, I know I may be losing my job, but Father God, I know you will help me. Show me what to do, Lord. You see, it's a switch, just an instant, you know, immediate switch that you can do every time an anxious thought comes into your head. And the more you do it, guess what? It becomes easier, and you're going to find yourself doing it more and more as you go through life. I want you to look what it says here in Ephesians chapter 6, verse 18. It says here, pray in the Spirit at all times, on every occasion. Stay alert and be persistent in your prayers for all believers everywhere. And I have to say, you know, when there is a lack of prayer in our lives, yeah, you're going to be able to tell if there is, because guess what? You're going to start depending on yourselves instead of God. That's usually an indicator that you haven't been praying as much as you should. Suddenly, you try to find answers on your own instead of going to Father God. And when we pray without ceasing, we will always be communing with Him and be depending on Him in every situation. I'm talking every situation in our lives. Doesn't matter if you think it's big or small. No, every situation, you're going to be depending on Him. Yeah, even maybe you cannot find a parking space at Costco. Yeah, you say, Lord, please provide a parking space. And you just be amazed, He will. And this is what it means to pray in the Spirit. Just to have such a dependence on Him. And you're praying straight from your heart. You know, it doesn't have to sound fancy or impressive or, you know, some people pray, great thou almightiest God and everlasting Father. You know, if you pray like that, that's okay. But, you know, don't pray it because you want to impress others, or you may think you may be impressing God. No, God just wants your heart. Just speak from your heart. And God, He is all ears. I want you to look what it says here, Matthew 6, verses 7 to 8. It says here, Jesus says, and when you pray, do not heap up empty phrases as the Gentiles do, for they think that they will be heard for their many words. Look what Jesus says here, verse 8, do not be like them, for your Father knows what you need before you ask Him. And you know, the reason why prayers may have empty words or empty phrases is because, guess what? They lack heart and meaning, because, yeah, it's not really from the heart. You're just maybe saying these things. Maybe you want to impress someone who is praying with you. Or, you know, you may think, oh, I think God would be impressed with these fancy words that I'm spewing out. No, just pray from your heart. You know, God, He will receive it as He knows that you are really showing to Him that you're depending on Him. Look what it says here in Isaiah 29, verse 13. It says here, the Lord says, these people come near to me with their mouth and honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. Their worship of me is based on merely human rules they have been taught. And you know, here's the thing. They may have been taught to pray a certain way, you know, growing up, you know, say, this is the words you must use, and, you know, and they make it sound like so, like, formulated, like, you know what I mean? Where it's like they have to say these exact words every time they pray. No, you can just say whatever is in your heart, and God will receive it. And for Christians, you know, prayer should be like breathing. Just think about this. Do you have to think to breathe? You know, I mean, just think about it. Every time we breathe, we gotta think about it before we breathe. No, we don't, because we know the atmosphere, right, exerts pressure on your lungs and essentially forces you to breathe. And breathing, it's natural, right, for us to do. I'm gonna tell you, so it is with praying. And you know, when we hold our spiritual breaths for long periods of time, I'm going to say our relationship with God will be affected. And that's why we got to make sure we're always in that prayer mode, you know, that as soon as we step out of the house, we're saying, Lord, I'm ready for the world because I know you're with me. Father, speak to me the whole day, Lord. Help me to say the right things and do the right things. You know, someone once said, for someone who says they cannot pray or have difficulty praying, you know, let him go to the sea and get lost, and he will be a mighty man of prayer in no time. Isn't that true? Sometimes it's when the difficult times come or times of confusion come, then we're praying all the time, right? We don't say, oh, I don't know what to say, or oh, I don't know if I can pray. No, you're praying because you know you're desperate for God. And here's the thing. You don't want a desperate situation to come upon you in order for you to become a prayer warrior. You know, when you have such a desperation for God right now, right? Guess what's going to happen? Less desperate situations will come upon your life because you are always in tune to his voice. When you truly have a desperateness for God all the time, you're always going to hear his voice. And you're not going to panic when difficult times come because you're going to hear the voice of the Holy Spirit instantly. When you know, you're starting to feel a little anxious or maybe you don't know what to do. You know, when George Mueller was asked how much time he spent in prayer, you know what his reply was? He said, hours every day. But he continued to say, but I live in the spirit of prayer. I pray as I walk and when I lie down and when I arise. And the answers are always coming. Wow, I like that. You know, he says the answers are always coming. It's because he's constantly in prayer mode. You get that? It's when you're always looking to God. You realize as you breathe in the very air that you know is from the Lord, guess what? You know at the same time, he's speaking to you. He's showing to you what you need to do throughout the day. And it really seems that the more you pray, the more of God's power and presence will be upon your life. And we need as much as we can get. Because I'm going to tell you, the devil will always be there to try to oppose us. He ain't going to stop. You know, he always wants to give us a hard time. And that's why you got to be in constant prayer mode. You know, there's a true story about a Christian leader. Well, we'll just call him Steve. And he was traveling recently by plane. And he noticed that the man sitting two seats over was thumbing through some little cards and moving his lips. And the man looked like a professor with his goatee and graying brown hair. And Steve guessed that he was probably around 50 years old. And thinking the man was a fellow believer, Steve, he leaned over to engage him in conversation. And he says to him, looks to me like you're memorizing something. And the man responded, no, actually, I was praying. So, you know, Steve kind of introduced himself and he said to him, hey, I believe in prayer too. And the man just responded, well, I have a specific assignment though. And Steve asked, so what's that? And the man responded, I'm praying for the downfall of Christian pastors. Oh. And Steve, he says, well, I would certainly fit into that category. And Steve asked him, so is my name on the list? And the man replied, not on my list, but I'm sure, yeah, probably on someone else's list. And we gotta realize, yeah, there's a lot of evil in this world, and probably there may be people that are praying against you, right? They're praying evil prayers though, right? They're praying things that will bring you down instead of lift you up unto the Lord. And so that makes it even more important that we have to be praying at all times, because if you know there's someone that's praying against you, right? We gotta crush that with our own prayers as we give it unto the Lord, as we pray unto the Lord. Amen. Well, I want you to look at point number three here. It says, we must give thanks in all circumstances. You know, if we can truly live a life of rejoicing always and praying without ceasing, you know what's going to happen? The end result is that you're going to be thankful in every situation and every circumstance. You know, this is what Paul says in Ephesians chapter 5. I want you to look what it says there, starting at verse 20. It says here, and give thanks for everything to God the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. You know, once again, as we are to have joy in the good times as well as the bad, you know, it's the same for giving thanks, you know. But when you already have that joy in your heart and you're praying constantly, it's going to be so much easier to give thanks, not only in the good times, but even in the bad times. You know, there was this woman who wrote a letter to the Billy Graham Evangelistic Association, and she asked them the following question. She asked, you know, our pastor gave a sermon recently about how we ought to thank God for everything. But she asked, how can we be thankful when bad things happen to us? You know, she then says that she is fighting cancer right now, and that she admits that she doesn't feel very thankful right now. If anything, she says she feels angry and depressed. And this was their answer. They said to her, your pastor was right. We should be thankful to God for everything that happens to us, both good and bad. The Bible says, rejoice always, pray continually, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. And that's the verse we covered today in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. But they asked her, is this realistic or even possible? And they say, yes, it is, once we understand why we should be thankful. And they said to her, take your situation for example. Cancer is a terrible disease, and we aren't called to be thankful for things that are evil, but you can be thankful that God has promised you to be with you, that he has promised to be with you, even when life isn't the way you wish it were. We are never alone when we know Christ, they say. God's promise is true. Never will I leave you, never will I forsake you. And that's in Hebrews 13:5. And they say we can also be thankful for the hope that we have because of Jesus Christ. Hopefully you'll be cured, and you certainly should pray that this will happen, they say to her. But death comes eventually to us all. And when we know Christ, we know we will be with him in heaven forever. Even in life's hardest times, we have hope. And if you have never done so, turn to Christ and ask him to come into your life. Then thank him every day that he is with you and ahead of you, and ahead of you is heaven. And sometimes even life's hardest times become a blessing, because through them we discover God's love for us. And the Bible says, come near to God and he will come near to you. And you know, this is what it says in 2 Corinthians. This is what Paul says. He says here, starting with verse 19 to 22, chapter 1, it says here, Timothy and Silvanus and I have preached to you about Jesus Christ, the Son of God. In him there is no yes and no, In him is yes. Jesus says yes to all of God's many promises. It is through Jesus that we say, amen, let it be so, when we give thanks to God. And God is the one who makes our faith and your faith strong in Christ. He has set us apart for himself. He has put his mark on us to show we belong to him. And his Spirit is in our hearts to prove this. You know, I really believe that when we are to give thanks to God in every situation. You know, whether good or bad, we will be able to have more of a deeper trust in God when we pray. And especially when we say amen, which means so be it, right? And when we say amen after our prayer, we should really mean it from deep within our hearts. And it should be that as we say it, it's saying so be it according to your will, Lord God, not mine. Because here's the thing. Too often, a believer may believe that when he or she says amen after his or her prayer, right? It means, okay, Lord, now you must do exactly as I ask. No, it should be actually, we're saying, okay, Lord, you do whatever is best for me. I'll trust in you. You know, when we can go to God and tell him that, you know, instead of saying, okay, now that I prayed it, you have to do it. No. Instead, you should be praying, Lord, I know you're going to bring forth your best as I offer this prayer to you. Go ahead, Lord. Do whatever you need to do. And as you do that, you know the Lord is pleased. And the Lord, he will show his power in your life. You know, one day, you know, there was this man. His name is Towler. And he met this beggar. And he says to him, God give you a good day, my friend. And the beggar answered, I thank God that I never had a bad one. Then Towler says, God give you a happy life, my friend. And the beggar says, I thank God I am never unhappy. You know, Towler, in amazement, says, what do you mean? Well, said the beggar, when it is fine, I thank God. When it rains, I thank God. When I have plenty, I thank God. When I'm hungry, I thank God. And since God's will is my will, and whatever pleases him pleases me, why should I say I am unhappy when I am not? You know, Towler, he looked at the man in astonishment, and he asked him, who are you? And the beggar responded, I am a king. And Towler asked him, so where then is your kingdom? And the beggar answered very quietly, in my heart. Wow. And the question is the kingdom of God in your heart? Because if it is, guess what? You're going to respond to the worst of worst situations with great peace. With great joy. Look what it says here in Isaiah 26, verse 6. It says here, you will keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on you because he trusts in you. And that's what you're going to have. You're going to have this perfect peace knowing that Jesus is going to be right there with you. He's going to give you a peace that will just touch your heart. And you're not going to allow worry or anxiety to come in. And certainly this peace you will always have as long as you have a thankful heart. You know for a fact that God is with you. He will never leave you. He will never forsake you. Well, I want you to take a look at the bottom line verses now. You know, in the last part of the scripture in Thessalonians chapter 5, it reads, do not quench the spirit. And you know, one definition of quench, it says here in the dictionary, is to extinguish a fire. To extinguish a fire. You know, I gotta say, when we choose not to make prayer a priority in our lives, and there's a lack of prayer in our lives, you know, what we can do is certainly extinguish the Holy Spirit's fire in our own hearts. And that's why we got to make sure we're in constant prayer mode. You know, our churches today need to be a spiritual house on fire for the Lord. And many times our churches have become instead a social house, whereas one old preacher had said the following. He said, we traded our upper room to become the boardroom. We traded the fire of the Holy Spirit for a warm heater. We traded our prayer meetings for chicken dinners. And we have become as weak as our tea, cold as our soup, and dead as the chicken that we eat. Yes, brothers and sisters, we gotta be careful that we do not quench the Spirit. We do not extinguish the fire of the Holy Spirit. Because if we do, we're going to have a dead church. You know, there's this pastor, his name is Tony Evans. You know, he's this popular African-American preacher from Texas. And he spoke of being in an elevator in a high-rise building. And he said he'd never been particularly comfortable in such elevators. You know, there was something about riding up and down in a little box several hundred feet off of the ground that had never set well with him. And he worried, right, that something would go wrong. And guess what? One day it did. The elevator he was riding in got stuck in between floors. Oh, can you imagine how scary that is, right? And it got stuck in between floors, way up in the higher floors. And he noticed that some of the people, oh, they just became frantic. They just started to push the panic button. And they began to beat on the door, hoping to get someone's attention. You know, others began to yell in the hopes that their voices would get someone on the surrounding floors to come to their aid. But nobody heard the noise or their cries. And Evans, you know what he did? He just quietly made his way to the front of the elevator. He opened a little door in the wall and he pulled out a telephone. Immediately, he was connected with someone on the outside. Here's the thing. He didn't need to beat on the wall to get their attention. He didn't need to speak loudly in the phone to receive their help. He could have whispered and they would have heard him. They would have still brought the help that they all needed. And you know, Evans said that in this world, we're going to get stuck in places we're not comfortable with. And some people, you know, begin to beat against the walls. Others cry out in total dismay. But the person who trusts in the power of confident prayer knows that there's always someone on the other end who hears them. And this is what it says in Psalm 145, 18 to 19. It says here, the Lord is close to all who call on him. Yes, to all who call on him in truth. He grants the desires of those who fear him. He hears their cries for help and he rescues them. And you gotta realize, yeah, God, he's just a call away. You call on his name, you call on the name of Jesus, and you're going to know he's going to be there for you. And he will display his power, he will show you his love. And that's why it's so important. We just got to get into that mode of praying without ceasing. It's because when we do, I'm going to tell you, we're going to experience a great revival. Our hearts will be revived. And we're going to experience the greatness of God's life inside of us when we truly trust in him and believe in him with all of our hearts. Amen. Praise God. Why don't we go ahead? Let's bow our heads. Let's bow our hearts. Let's come before our Father in heaven. Father God, we just want to thank you, Lord, for the message spoken today. And I thank you, Lord, as we truly understand, it's so important that we always got to be in prayer mode. And that's what it's referring to when it tells us that we must pray. You know, it's the kind of prayer that we can just have a conversation with you throughout the day. And we know that your Holy Spirit will always speak to us, always counsel us when we just call upon you, when we just desire you, Lord. You're going to show up. You're going to let us know that you will never leave us, you will never forsake us, because our lives truly belong to you. Lord, I thank you, Lord, for for what you have spoken into us today. I pray that all my brothers and sisters, as they receive your word today, if they're experiencing any frustrations, any discouragement, Father, right now in the name of your son Jesus, Father, I just pray, Lord, they will just allow their mind, their hearts, and their spirit just to be totally in the presence of our Lord Jesus Christ. As they give their lives fully unto you, I just pray they're going to experience the fullness of who you are. Lord, we love you and we praise you. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, we pray all these things. And everyone says, amen. Well, praise God and praise God. I'll see you next week, part 3. Have an awesome, awesome day. And remember, give God all the glory. Amen.